Good morning, all. Good morning, church. Steal that from Michael.
I didn't originate it.
No, I don't think you probably did. But I'm going to steal it anyway. Good to see everybody here this morning. Couple of announcements before we open worship service with a prayer. If you are visiting with us, we thank you for being here. We appreciate it. Knowing that you have other things that you could be doing, and yet you chose to worship God this morning with us. If you need a restroom, there's one over in the corner, out through the foyer to the left. If you need a drink of water, some cold water, right in the foyer to your right, there's a refrigerator. You're welcome to help yourself to some cold water there. If you're visiting and you would like to fill out a visitor's card, there's one on the back of the chair. If you would fill that out, drop it in the collection tray as it comes around. We will acknowledge you at the end of worship service, and we also would appreciate having a record of your visit so that we might be able to get a hold of you. If you have prayer requests, also there's a card on the back of the chair for prayer requests. If you fill one of those out, Bruce will address that prior to the sermon. We also would ask that if you have cell phones, most of you do, either put them on vibrate or silent or shut them off so we don't interrupt worship service. A couple of announcements. I sent out an email on Vallon the other day. Bruce was just asking me for clarification on that. They're having their election during this period of time. And during the election, they are not allowed to carry any large sum of amount of money in their pockets. So for him to go to Western Union and get a large sum of money, he can't do that. They won't let him. So I do have to send his money this week instead of next week. I told Bruce, I said, we think we've got election problems, so does India. Because the reason they can't carry the money is they're afraid somebody's going to buy a vote. So it goes on everywhere. We just deal with it and move on. So anyway, that's the situation on Vallon. So if you are planning to help with that work, if you would see me and give me your money either this morning or tonight, I'll be back. I'm preaching tonight. We're going to talk about gossip. So I'd like to have everybody back for that. A couple other announcements. Kurt has given me he's got a note. The men are seeking volunteers to work as a group, to track attendance, and also to conduct an outreach program. If we're conducting attendance in the mornings and evenings, then we can know who's not here and who is. And if you'd like to be on that committee, and then to outreach to those that aren't here, to see what the problem might be, or visitation. See Van, he's the head of the group. He's a one-man show right now. So he wants to be the head of a group. Also, Sam has asked me to make an announcement. He said you're good through April, but after April he needs people to sign up to help with cleaning of the building. There's a sign-up sheet back in the foyer. If you have questions or you don't know quite what that involves, you can see Sam and Cena or Tana or Pete or any of those. They'll be glad to fill you in on what needs to be done. That's all I've got, I think. Was that long enough? Let's go to our Father in prayer. Our Father in heaven, we come to you this morning. We humble ourselves as we approach your throne. We give you all the honor, all the glory, and all the praise, knowing full well, Father, that the things that we accomplish, the things that we do on this earth, can't be done without your help. We also acknowledge, Father, that you are in control. And with our faith in you, we know that, we understand that, and we can't let those things in life get in our way. Father, we ask you this morning, and we give thanks to you for your Son that you sent to this earth, to not only be born here, but to live and walk on this earth so that we might have an example to pattern our lives after. They then put him on a cross. He died a horrible death. And then he was buried and he was resurrected. And we understand, Father, that he did all that for us. You did all that for us. That we might have a chance for salvation. That we have remission of sin through baptism. And if we continue to live a faithful life after the baptism, you have made us a promise that you will guarantee us a place in heaven. We thank you, Father, for that. We thank you this morning that we can gather in this building, worship you, that we can commune with you and remember that death, burial, and resurrection. We thank you, Father, we have the opportunity to lift our voices to you this morning in praise. We ask that as we sing these songs that we understand what we're saying, we understand the praise and the promises that we're making to you. We also understand, Father, that we are teaching others by what these songs say. Father, we thank you this morning for Bruce and Stacy and those that work in this congregation. We ask you especially be with Bruce this morning as he opens up your word and departs a portion of it to us. We ask that we'd have open hearts and open minds that we might be able to take in and understand what he has to say to us. We ask that it might influence us and influence our lives to not only make us better Christians, but to also be able to teach others. We thank you, Father, for the many blessings that we have in this country and in our lives. We're a very blessed people, a very blessed nation, and we know that it's because of you, and we thank you for that. Father, we ask you this morning to be with those of our leadership that are on foreign soil, those in our navies and our armies, our service people. We would ask that you would keep them safe, that they would be able to return to the States and return to their families safely. We ask you, Father, to be with the first responders that we have, especially in this city. Be with them and guide them and protect them and let their lives be lived that they might stay safe and that they might be able to return their families at the end of shifts. Father, as we go into this worship service this morning, we would ask that you would lift the sins off our shoulders. We know we sin often, we know we fall short, and we ask forgiveness for that. And it's through Christ we pray. Amen.
Morning, church. First song today will be number 703. Jesus is coming soon. Troublesome times are here, filling men's hearts with fear. Freedom we all hold dear, now is at stake. Humble your heart to God, safe from the chastening rod. Seek the pilgrims trod, Christians awake. Jesus is coming soon, morning or night or noon. Many will meet their doom, trumpets will sound. All of the dead shall rise, righteous meet in the skies, going where no one dies, heavenward bound. Left so many cold, losing their home of gold, this in God's word is told, evils abound. When these signs come to pass near the end at last, it will come very fast, trumpets will sound. Jesus is coming soon, morning or night or noon, many will meet their doom, trumpets will sound. All the dead shall rise, righteous meet in the skies, going where no one dies, heavenward bound. Troubles will soon be o'er, happy forevermore, when we meet on that shore from care. Rising up in the sky, telling the world goodbye, homeward we then will fly, glory to share. Jesus is coming soon, morning or night or noon, many will meet their doom, trumpets will sound. All the dead shall rise, righteous meet in the sky, going where no one dies, heavenward bound. Amen. Number 794. No Tears in Heaven, 794. After this song, we'll have a scripture reading by Rader Mago. 794. And I'd like to remind everyone after this song and for the scripture reading, if it's convenient, everyone please stand. No tears in heaven, no tear is given, all will be glory in that land. There'll be no sadness, all will be gladness, when we shall join that happy band. No tears, no tears, no tears up there, sorrow and pain will all have flown. No tears, no tears, no tears up there, no tears in heaven will be known. Glory is waiting, waiting up yonder, where we shall spend an endless day. There with our Savior will be forever, where no more sorrow can dismay. No tears, no tears, no tears up there, sorrow and pain will all have flown. No tears, no tears, no tears up there, no tears in heaven will be known. Some morning yonder we'll cease to ponder o'er things this life has brought to view. All will be clearer, loved ones be dearer, in heaven where all will be made new. No tears, no tears, no tears up there, sorrow and pain will all have flown. No tears, no tears, no tears up there, no tears in heaven, maybe no.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Today's scripture reading will be from Romans chapter 12, verses 6. And it reads, having them gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us, let us use them. If prophecy, let us prophesy in proportion to our faith.
If you would, mark your songbooks at number 707. 707 will be the song following communion and just prior to the contribution. And for communion, we'll sing number 359, O Sacred Head. 359. O sacred head, now wounded, with grief and shame weighed down, now scornfully surrounded, with thorns thine only crown. Art thou pale with anguish, with sore abuse and scorn? How does that visage languish, which once was bright as morn? What thou, my Lord, hast suffered, what sinner gay. Mine was the transgression, but thine the deadly pain. Lo, here I fall, my Savior, 'tis I deserve thy place. Look on me with thy favor, vouchsafe to me thy grace. What language shall I borrow to thank thee, dearest friend, for this thy dying sorrow, thy pity without end? Oh, make me thine forever, and should I fainting be, Lord, let me never, never outlive my love to thee.
Together we take time now to be a part of this communion service, to be a part of this memorial, to remember Christ, to reflect back and consider all that he's done for us, to remember his life, his death, his burial, and his resurrection, to be reminded that he's now seated at the right hand of God and that someday he'll come again. Jesus, when he was with his disciples, knowing that he would soon be led away to be crucified, he instituted this Lord's Supper and he instructed them to do this in remembrance of him. In a like manner, we too do this in remembrance of him by sharing the emblems, the bread that represents Christ's body, and by partaking of the cup that represents his blood that was shed upon the cross for each of us. In the book of Luke, when Luke was talking about Jesus and talking about the events leading up to the crucifixion of Jesus, starting in Luke 22 and 63, it goes on to read, "Now the men who had held Jesus mocked him and beat him, and having blindfolded him, they struck him on the face and asked him, saying, 'Prophesy, who is the one who struck you?' And many other things they blasphemously spoke against him. As soon as it was day, the elders of the people, both chief priests and scribes, came together, led him into their council, saying, 'If you are the Christ, tell us.' But he said to them, 'If I tell you, you will by no means believe. And if I also ask you, you will by no means answer. Answer me, or let me go. Hereafter, the Son of Man will sit on the right hand of the power of God.' Then they all said, 'Are you then the Son of God?' So he said to them, 'You rightly say that I am.' And they said, 'What further testimony do we need? For we have heard it ourselves from his own mouth.' Then the whole multitude of them arose and led him to Pilate, and they began to accuse him, saying, 'He found this fellow perverting the nation and forbidding to pay taxes to Caesar, saying that he himself is Christ, a king.' Then Pilate asked him, saying, 'Are you the king of the Jews?' He answered and said to him, 'It is as you say.' So Pilate said to the chief priest and the crowd, 'I find no fault in this man.' But they were the more fierce, saying, 'He stirs up the people, teaching throughout all the Judea, beginning from Galilee to this place.' When Pilate had heard of Galilee, and he asked if the man were of Galilean, as soon as he knew that he belonged to Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him to Herod, who was also in Jerusalem at that time. Now when Herod had saw Jesus, he was exceedingly glad, for he had desired for a long time to see him, because he had heard many things about him, and he hoped to see some miracle done by him. Then he questioned him with many words, but he answered him nothing. And the chief priests, scribes, stood and vehemently accused him. Then Herod, with his men of war, treated him with contempt and mocked him, arrayed him in a gorgeous robe, and sent him back to Pilate. That very day, Pilate and Herod became friends with each other, for previously they had been at enmity with each other. Then Pilate, when he had called together the chief priests, the rulers, and the people, said to them, "You have brought this man to me as one who misleads the people. And indeed, having examined him in your presence, I have found no fault in this man concerning those things of which you accuse him. No, neither did Herod, for I sent you back to him, and indeed nothing deserving of death has been done by him. I will therefore chastise him and release him, for it was necessary for him to release one to them at the feast." And they all cried out at once, saying, "Away with this man, and release to us Barabbas, who had been thrown into the prison for a certain rebellion made in the city, and for murder." Pilate, therefore, wishing to release Jesus, again called out to them, but they shouted, saying, "Crucify him, crucify him." Then he said to them the third time, "Why, what evil has he done? I have found no reason for death in him. I will therefore chastise him and let him go." But they were insistent, demanding with loud voices that he be crucified. And the voices of these men and of the chief priests prevailed. So Pilate gave sentence that it should be as they requested, and released to them one they requested, who for rebellion and murder had been thrown into prison, but he delivered Jesus to their will. And skipping on to 32, it goes on to say, there were also two others, criminals, led with him to be put to death. And when they had come to that place called Calvary, there they crucified him, and the criminals, one on the right hand and the other on the left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do." And when they divided his garments and cast lots, and the people stood looking on, but even the rulers with them sneered, saying, "He saved others, let him save himself. He is the Christ, the chosen God." The soldiers also mocked him, coming off and offering him sour wine, and saying, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." And an inscription also was written over him in letters of Greek, Latin, and Hebrew, "This is the King of the Jews." Then one of the criminals who were hanged blasphemed him, saying, "If you are the Christ, save yourself and us." But the other answering rebuked him, saying, "Do you not even fear God, seeing you are under the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we receive due reward for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said to Jesus, "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus said to him, "Assuredly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise." Now it was about the sixth hour, and there was darkness over all the earth until the ninth hour. Then the sun was darkened, and the veil of the temple was torn in two. And when Jesus had cried out with a loud voice, he said, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." Having said this, he breathed his last. As we take time now to share in this communion, may we remember Christ and all that he's done for us. May we know that he loves each of us, and he's demonstrated his love toward us by freely fulfilling the will of the Father, by coming to this earth and going to the cross and offering there himself as a sacrifice for the sins of the world, so that through his death upon the cross we might have forgiveness, we might be redeemed and reconciled back to God the Father in close relationship and given that hope of eternal life. And at the same time, may we be mindful of that and remember that although this is a solemn time and a serious time as we contemplate Christ's death and what he's done for us, may we be reminded of the victory that we share in as Christian, and that his victory is over self. For we are no longer bound by the things of our past and weighed down by the errors of our past, as we're instructed and told that if any man is in Christ, he's a new creation. Old things have passed away and new things have become. And again, we're told in Psalms that as far as the east is from the west, that our sins are forgiven from us. So at this time, may we remember Christ, and as we take time to share in these emblems, may we pray together at this time as we ask Sam to offer a prayer for the bread.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we approach your throne for mercy and grace and with hearts of thanksgiving, and we thank you for this Lord's Day. Thank you, Father, for allowing us to be here to gather with the saints and to commune with you and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Help us to examine ourselves on this day. Help us to focus fully on Jesus and the sacrifice that he went through. Help us to also remember his life, things that he's done, the miracles, the blessings, the teachings that he's done, everything about him, Father, that brings us here today. And as we take this, as we commune with you and our Savior, Father, we ask that you bless this bread, which represents the body of Christ, And those who partake in it, do it in a manner that's pleasing to you. We ask all these things in your Son Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
At this time, we'll ask Frank to offer a prayer for the cup.
Heavenly Father, as we continue our thanks for this cup, we are grateful for everything that our Lord and our Savior went through for us, for our sin. We're so thankful, Father, that you've given us this command to remember him each and every Lord's Day, that we can honor him and give him glory for what he is. What he is, he's our King, the Lord of our life, and we're so grateful that he gave his life. We are happy to give back ours to him. And we pray, Father, as we partake of this cup, that you bless each member here this morning as they partake of it. Help us grow stronger in our faith. We understand that it symbolizes the blood that was shed, and help us remember what he went through as we do this. Once again, Father, we offer this prayer in his precious name. Amen.
Number 707. On bended knee I come,
With a humble heart I come, bowing down before your holy name. Lifting holy hands to you, as I pledge my life anew, I worship you in spirit, I worship you in truth. Make my life a holy praise unto you. On bended knee I come, with a broken heart I come, bowing down before your holy throne. As I look upon your face, show your mercy and your grace. Change my life, O Holy Spirit. Make me fresh and ever new. Make my life a holy sacrifice to you.
Together we take time now in our service to give back a portion of that which God has blessed us with. As we gather here today, we recognize, acknowledge all that God has done for us, for the blessings that we share in. We're instructed to lay by in store and to give back as we've been prospered, to not give grudgingly or under compulsion, but give cheerfully, for God loves a cheerful giver. We give to support the work of the church, to provide for the means of the church, to help in our evangelism efforts, if it be here locally or through the evangelism efforts that we support throughout the world, if it be in India or if it be with Malcolm Parsley in South Korea and the efforts in Mexico. Through our contributions, we are making a difference in the world to help share and spread the gospel so that others too may come to know and have a personal relationship with God through his son, Jesus. Please let us pray together as we offer a prayer for the offering. Father God in heaven, we thank you for this day, Lord, for allowing us to awake and be a part of it, and for the privilege we have to assemble here as brothers and sisters in Christ, to be a part of this service, to be encouraged and encourage one another and to have an opportunity to give back a portion of that which you have blessed us with, Lord, so that the monies received will be used to further your work, to build up your church here in this community, to support the ministries and evangelism efforts that we support throughout the world, Father. We pray, Father, that the monies received will be used to in accordance with your will, to spread the gospel message so that others ultimately come to know and have that personal relationship with you through your son, Jesus. We ask, Father, that you be with us now as we give back. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Please mark your songbooks at number 695 will be the song following the lesson this morning, 695. And before Bruce's lesson, we'll sing number 738, I Love to Tell a Story, 738.
I love to tell the story of unseen things above, of Jesus and his glory, of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story because I know it is true. It satisfies my longings as nothing else can do. I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my theme in glory to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story, most wonderful seems, than all the golden fancies of all my golden dreams. I love to tell the story, it did so much for me, and that is just a reason I tell it now to thee. I love to tell the story, 'twill be my theme in glory to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story for those who know it best, seem hungering and thirsting to hear it like the rest. And when in scenes of glory I sing the new song, 'twill be the old, old story that I have loved so long. I love to tell the story, 'twill be my theme in glory to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love.
Good morning. Thank you, Kurt, for those wonderful hymns that you led. I want to welcome all the visitors that we have. We have a number of visitors with us, some from here in Las Vegas, some from North Carolina, some from, I think, all the way from Italy, if I remember right. And so we extend a very special welcome to you. Glad that you came to worship with us. Wanted to remind everybody that the area-wide singing is today, and it's up at the Bright Angel Church of Christ up in the northwest part of town. That starts at 2 o'clock. I want to not only welcome everybody here, but those that faithfully watch us online when they can't be here, people like Barbara, Ken and Dana Walker, are watching today. Ken just had his hip surgery. He's home. He's doing well. Tracy and Marion, and also Joyce. It was mentioned in the bulletin. We need to keep Joyce in our prayers. She was recently diagnosed with Parkinson's disease, and so we'll remember her. It's nice to see Sherry with us today. She You've had a bout with some sickness lately, and it's very nice to see you. Sherry watches regularly when she's not here, and we're very glad that we have that ability to do that. Keep Tanya. Many of you remember Tanya. She hasn't lived here for a few years now. She lives back in Ohio now, kind of plays part-time grandma and also takes care of her mom. So, but she, I think she was crowned Demolition Derby Queen of Ohio the other day. She was in a wreck, rolled her car three times. She came out without a scratch. Last I heard, didn't even break a fingernail. Car's a mess, but I'm sure she's probably bruised and sore from something like that. But luckily, she's okay. She sends her best, and we give our best to her. Catherine Sales, as always, gives God all glory and praises God for his grace and asks prayers for her son, Javante. His car was stolen from his home yesterday, and she requests prayers for him. Some of our visitors, Misty, Ada, and Rainey, have asked prayers for their mom, Carol McCaw. She is in a rehab center recovering from open heart surgery. And so we will keep her in prayer. And we need to keep Dick and Peggy in our prayers. Next week, Dick's going to be teaching and preaching out at Pahrump. We're thankful that he has the opportunity to do that. And he does such a good job for that congregation out there. Let's go to God in prayer right now, and then we will get into our lesson. Dear Heavenly Father, we humbly come to you, thanking you for all the blessings that you give us. Dear God, a number of people need your special hand for illness, for spiritual encouragement, for health, either for themselves or their family members. Dear God, we ask that you be with all of our concerns, all of our fears, all of our worries. We know that you are God of all. Dear God, we ask that you be with us as we continue our worship to you. We hope that everything that has and will be done is pleasing and glorifying to you, and that it's done in spirit and in truth. We ask that you be with your church worldwide today, that they are worshiping in spirit and in truth, and that they are spreading the gospel to those that hear. We ask that you be with Dick as he goes to prep next week to do that. Dear God, again, thank you, and we pray everything through your son Jesus. Amen. I'd mentioned to the men in the our little meeting before worship that I wanted to thank them. In a lot of ways, this sermon came about from thinking about not only the men, but everybody that contributes to worship services. And I don't know if sometimes you fully realize the role that you play, even if it's in attendance. But we're going to be taking the bulk of our lesson from the book of Numbers in number 16. And I've titled it, Is It a Small Thing? And this is an example of some people doing things the wrong way. It's the rebellion of Korah. And I'd like to read, it's a relatively long passage for what I normally do. It's 35 verses, but if you wanted to turn there and read in your Bible along as I'm reading out of the New King James Version, That's the where this is taken from, and we'll go ahead and get started. It starts off in verse 1. It says, now Korah, the son of Izhar, the son of Kohath, the son of Levi, with Dathan and Abiram, the sons of Eliab, and On, the son of Peleth, sons of Reuben, took men, and they rose up before Moses with some of the children of Israel. 250 leaders of the congregation, representatives of the congregation, men of renown. Without reading any farther, I already see where this is going. Rising up against Moses. It's already painting a bad picture. But it says these were leaders of the congregation. These were men of renown. You got to watch it. You got to check yourself, whoever you are. I don't care who you are. I don't care if you're a preacher. I don't care if you're an elder. I don't care who you are. You got to check yourself once in a while. And know who you are and know your place. Verse 2, and they rose up before Moses and says, these are men of renown. They gathered together against Moses and Aaron and said to them, you take too much upon yourselves, for all the congregation is holy, every one of them, and the Lord is among them. Why then do you exalt yourselves above the assembly of the Lord? Don't you see this happening all the time in a worldly setting? Sometimes even in a religious setting, but especially in a worldly setting, people mask what they're really saying. They're coming, oh, you guys are taking on too much. And then they get to it, you know, the whole people are holy. Why are you exalting yourselves above the assembly? If you think back, Moses did everything he could not to be in that position. He tried to talk his way out of it with God to not be the leader. But God wanted him the leader. So when Moses heard it, he fell on his face and he spoke to Korah. It's like incoming. Moses knows this ain't going to end pretty. He hears them chirping, running their mouths, what God had set up. What's he do? Before anything, he falls on his face because he knows something's about to happen and it ain't going to be pretty. He falls on his face saying, he spoke to Korah and all his company saying, tomorrow morning, the Lord will show who is his and who is holy and will cause him to come near to him. That one whom he chooses, he will cause to come near to him. Then Moses said to Korah, hear now, you sons of Levi, is it a small thing to you that the God of Israel has separated you from the congregation of Israel to bring you near to himself, to do the work of the tabernacle of the Lord, and to stand before the congregation to serve him? And that he has brought you near to himself, you and all your brethren, the sons of Levi with you. And are you seeking the priesthood also? Therefore, you and all your company are gathered together against the Lord. And what is Aaron that you complain against him? He's asking them a very sincere question. Is it a small thing? Are you wanting to be the priest too? Is it a small thing for people to set up the tabernacle? Is it a small thing to set up and to pack up on their movements the utensils of the holy place? Is it a small thing to hang the curtains up? You want to be priest too? You were called separate to do these special works. And you're not happy with that? You're not happy with the job you've been given? And that's what's being said. And Moses sent to call Dathan and Abiram, the sons of Eliab, but they said, "We will not come up." And then he turns, "Is it a small thing that you have brought us up out of the land flowing with milk and honey to kill us in the wilderness, that you should keep acting like a prince over us?" Oh, they're getting bold now. Goes on to say, "Moreover, you have not brought us into a land flowing with milk and honey, nor given us inheritance of fields and vineyards. Will you put out the eyes of these men? We will not come up." They're complaining. Moses, through God, delivered them out of slavery in Egypt. They witnessed all of those miracles, the hand of God, promised that they took them out of slavery and are going to a promised land. And they're griping, "You took us out of our situation that we were in. A condition of slavery. A condition where they're looking back with fondness of being in the condition they were in." Do we ever, now that we're Christians, long for and yearn for that old life? We should be so glad to be out of that. We should be counting our lucky stars that we're out of sin, that we're out of the world and now a Christian. Whatever our state is, whatever situation we're in is better than what we have left. They're longing for being back in slavery. Then Moses was very angry, and rightly so. I'm glad it was Moses instead of me. God knew what he was doing, picking Moses. He was only angry. I'd have been smoting people. Then Moses was very angry and said to the Lord, "Do not respect their offering. I have not taken one donkey from them, nor have I hurt any. Have I hurt one of them?" And Moses said to Korah, "Tomorrow you and all your company be present before the Lord, you and they, as well as Aaron. Let each take his censer and put incense in it, and each of you bring his censer before the Lord. 250 censers, both you and Aaron, each with his censer." The censers were, they put the incense in and they burnt it, and it was to be as sweet aromas to the Lord. So you and your 250 people, you each bring censers, and Aaron, you bring your censer. we're going to see how this goes. So every man took his censer, put fire in it, laid incense on it. I wonder if they ever thought back to some names, Nadab and Abihu. But that's another story. Laid incense on it and stood at the door of the tabernacle of meeting with Moses and Aaron. And Korah gathered all the congregation against them at the door of the tabernacle of meeting. Then the glory of the Lord appeared to all the congregation. And the Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron, saying, "Separate yourselves from among this congregation, that I may consume them in a moment." Step away, Moses and Aaron, because I'm getting ready to do what I do very well. Then they fell on their faces and said, "Oh God, the God of the spirits of all flesh, shall one man sin and you be angry with all the congregation?" One day we have to come back and visit verse 22 as a lesson. There's too much there for today. In fact, there's too much in this lesson for today. We're going to finish. We're going to cut it in half. It's already 11:30. Sorry. I misjudged this one. We're going to finish this in Numbers. So the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "Speak to the congregation, saying, get away from the tents of Korah, Dathan, and Abram." Then Moses rose and went to Dathan and Abram, and the elders of Israel followed him. And he spoke to the congregation, saying, "Depart now from the tents of these wicked men. Touch nothing of theirs, lest you be consumed in all their sins." So they got away from around the tents of Korah, Dathan and Abram. And Dathan and Abram came out and stood at the door of their tents with their wives, their sons, and their little children. And Moses said, "By this you will know that the Lord has sent me to do all these works, for I have not done them of my own will." It's not from Moses. It's from God. If these men die naturally, like all men, or if they're visited by the common fate of all men, then the Lord has not sent me. But if the Lord creates a new thing, and the earth opens up its mouth and swallows them up with all that belongs to them, and they go down alive into the pit, then you will understand that these men have rejected the Lord. Now it came to pass, as he finished speaking all these words, that the ground split apart under them, and the earth opened its mouth and swallowed them up with their households and all the men with Korah, with all their goods. So they and all those with them went down alive into the pit. The earth closed over them, and they perished from among the assembly. Not an average Tuesday. This is something that is going to be remembered. You're going to tell your children and grandchildren about this one. Then all Israel who were around them fled at their cry, for they said, "Lest the earth swallows us up also." And a fire came out from the Lord and consumed the 250 men who were offering incense. We're going to end here today. This is a good enough lesson in and of itself. They had jobs to do for the Lord, but they weren't happy with it. And they're angry with Moses. And the crazy thing, look ahead to verse 41 in your Bibles. After this all happened, and they started murmuring against Moses. After what do these people need? And I get around to say this. I started out thanking the people that contribute to our worship assemblies. Humbly. Selflessly. Whether it's offering the prayers for the Lord's Supper, song leading, whether it's the people that before today were cleaning the building so we'd have a nice place to come and worship. The ladies that prepared the communion. Could you imagine? Chris prepares all his lesson, you know, his remarks, gets up here for the Lord's Supper, and there's no Lord's Supper in the trays. It just didn't appear. Little communion elves didn't show up at night and do it. They weren't happy with the jobs they were given. And we see what happened to them. And Moses asked them, is it a small thing what God has separated you to do? But you want to do somebody else's job. Stay around and see what happens with that one. And we just saw. We're going to end our lesson here. Don't want to rush it. There's too much. Bring your outlines back next week. If you forget them, I'll run some more. We'll do the other half next week. This has been good messages from God, just this. We never, ever like to leave an assembly or a worship without offering an invitation. An invitation to become saved. An invitation to put your Lord on in baptism if you have not done so. We see too many places in the Bible where good people, Cornelius, it says a devout man, a good man, prayed to God, offered alms to the poor, was a good man, but he wasn't saved until he was baptized. On the day of Pentecost, it said that there were in Jerusalem devout Jews that believed in God. They're there to celebrate God, but they weren't saved until Peter preached a gospel sermon to them. They received it, realized what he said, cried out, men and brethren, what must we do to be saved? And Peter and the rest of them responded, repent and be baptized for the forgiveness of your sins. It's not hard to figure out. It's the same baptism that Lydia made. It's the same baptism that the Ethiopian eunuch went through. It's the same baptism that Raider just went through a couple of weeks ago, that Jeff Craig went through a few weeks ago, that Ramon went through a few months ago. It's the same baptism that you went through the day that you made that confession that Christ is the Son of God. and you put your Lord on in baptism and had your sins forgiven. If you have sin in your life, do not wait another minute to repent and to get back on track, worshiping, serving pleasingly to God. If there's prayers that you need and request in your life, whatever we can do for you. If you're looking for a church home, if you've tried some of the other churches of Christ in the valley and would like to drop anchor someplace and worship and work with a congregation, we would love to have you officially. Whatever your need, please come forward while we stand and sing. Kurt?
My stubborn will at last hath yielded. I would be thine and thine alone. And is the prayer my lips are bringing, Lord, let in me thy will be done. Sweet will of God, still fold me closer till I am wholly lost in thee. Sweet will of God, still fold me closer till I am wholly lost in thee. I'm tired of sin, footsore and weary. The darksome path hath dreary grown. But now a light has risen to cheer me. I find in thee my star, my sun. Sweet will of God, still fold me closer till I am wholly lost in thee. Sweet will of God, still fold me closer till I am wholly lost in thee. Thy precious will, O conquering Savior, doth now embrace and compass me. All discords hush, my peace a river, my soul a prison bird set free. Sweet will of God, still fold me closer till I am wholly lost in thee. Sweet will of God, still fold me closer till I am wholly lost in thee. Shut in with thee, O Lord, forever, my wayward feet no more to roam. What part from thee my soul can sever? The center of God's will, my home. Sweet will of God, still fold me closer till I am wholly lost in thee. Sweet will of God,
Thank you, Bruce, for that message. For the record, I don't want a bigger job, and I'm not complaining about anybody. Amen. Do have a couple of visitors' cards. Bruce already mentioned we have a number of visitors, but we have a card from Steve and Pat Tootin. Where are you folks at? Right over here. They're from Franklin, North Carolina. They've been with us before, have come back again. Glad to see you once more. Also, Misty Croman. Misty, where are you at? Right over here. Oh, back in the back, from Los Molinos, California, here for the first time. Glad to have you with us.
Also have Dan from Memphis.
Oh, Dan from Memphis. Good to have you with us. And any other visitors that we have, we're just glad you're all here. As we often say, there's lots of things you could be doing in Las Vegas. I don't know what those are. But I hear that there are other things you could be doing. And we're glad that you're not doing those and you're here with us to worship the Lord. We're honored by your presence. Let's go to the Lord in prayer to close our worship. Our Father God in heaven, we thank you for the blessing of this day, for the opportunity that we have had to come into your presence with those of like precious faith and worship you, we trust, Father, in spirit and in truth. We pray, Father, that as the words of your message from our brother and your servant Bruce have fallen on our ears this morning, that we will consider our place before you, that we will never seek to exalt ourselves beyond where we ought to be and who we are, but always to give the glory to you and to your Son, and to recognize that nothing that we do is to make ourselves look better or to glorify ourselves, but always to glorify the name of Jesus who gave his life for us. Father, we would just ask that as we depart from this gathering today, that you would be with us, that you would guide us, keep us safe as we go about the activities of our lives, and always, Father, help us in everything that we do, in every encounter we have with those around us, to lift up the light of Christ, to help people see in us that hope of glory who is Jesus Christ. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. Thank you.